Hi guys, I'm honest here. It looks like we have to install Windows 2000 and we should do it as quickly as possible.
Simon?
I want you to install Windows 2000 by 2 o'clock. Then I will call you again.
Windows 2000?
Yes, Windows 2000. I don't care if you're using a 486 or the latest Pentium Smintium computer. Get it done by 2 o'clock, connected to the internet, and you'll receive further instructions online.
No problem. Okay, let's do it. Between this AMD 486 DX4100 CPU and this Intel Core i3 13th Gen CPU, on what configuration do you think we can do it faster?
You kidding me? What kind of question is that?
Well, if we are installing it for the first time on new hardware, we have to take in consideration that Windows 2000 won't play nice when it comes to disk hardware. So the installation will require driver integration, troubleshooting, and possibly some additional hardware. On the other hand, a slow PC, even a very slow one like a 486, is out of the box compatible with Windows 2000. The installation will take a while, way longer by today's standards, but we can get the job done from the first try. First of all, can we install Windows 2000 on a 486 CPU? Well, we can. At the time, Microsoft believed there will be some demand. That's why Windows 2000 is the last NT-based Windows with support for the 486 architecture, which was released back in 1989. The motherboard that I'm using has PCI slots. It was released in 1995. It's a socket 3 MSI MS-4144 using the SIS-496 chipset. It was released in 1995. Same year, this AMD DX4100 CPU was launched. This was a duo meant for Windows 95, but let's see how it can handle Windows 2000, which is a more demanding operating system. For example, Windows 95 can work with only 8 megs of RAM, while Windows 2000 minimum requirements are 64 megs. In 1995, at $32 per megabyte, 64 megs of RAM would have increased the cost of this computer with about $2,000. Anyone would have bought a Pentium computer instead of a 486 with 64 megs of RAM. On a 486 configuration, the more RAM you have, the more external cache you have to add to make that RAM cacheable. For 64 megs, 256k of cache would be enough. That's why I extracted 128k of cache from this bad motherboard plagued by a leaky battery. The cache modules are different brands but with the same latency. The jumpers are configured correctly, so let's see. We should have 256k of cache, and we do have. Now let's install a Windows 2000 on this Transcend industrial 1 GB flash module. The installation files are located on a separate drive, this regular Maxtor drive manufactured in 1998. The motherboard has an AMI BIOS with ID setup utility, which can configure the drives automatically. The process simply works. Now that the drives are recognized, let's start the setup. I'm using a Windows 98 bootable floppy. We have to run a SmartDrive disk caching utility from the floppy. This is a very important step, or else the setup will take way longer than it should. Using a flash drive for the installation makes the DOS part of the setup very snappy. You wouldn't say that it runs on a 486. Anyway, this is the only snappy part of the installation. Oh, let's not forget that our ID drives are recognized without any problems. This is saving us a lot of time. Once the graphical part of the installation takes over, we can clearly see that our 486 CPU is not up to the task. There are many moments when you may think that the computer is frozen when it's actually not. This is a very sped up footage. But these screens that we are seeing now took hours. So to reach the desktop, the whole installation took between 2.5 and 3 hours. And it is what it is. We are using a 486 CPU, which runs a very demanding operating system. Once we are done with the installation, things are not getting any better. The system is somewhat usable, but it's not snappy at all. Sometimes the screen will draw in seconds. Everything feels laggy. Sometimes we make a right click and the menu will show up a few seconds later. Anyway, I remember that back in the days, these slower PCs were proposed to perform other tasks like setting up a print server or a mail server, and the user interface wasn't so important. It was more important to run a secure operating system like Microsoft Windows NT 4, or in this case, Windows 2000. Well, this is the end of the story for our 486 configuration. Now let's talk about new hardware.
Everybody is looking for the door to the new economy. But actually, it's a window.
Now let's ask the same question again. Can we run Windows 2000 on a modern PC? Yes, we can. Here is Windows 2000 running on my Ryzen 9 PC since 2020. The installation process is a little bit complicated, and not because we are having a fast CPU or too much RAM, but because of lack of USB support. Also, during the setup, our SATA drive won't be recognized, but we won't get that far without at least a functional keyboard. Of course, we can solve this problem easily by using PS2 ports if our motherboard provides them. But if we want to stick with USB ports, we have to find some compatible adapter. I recommend this PCI Express to USB 2 adapter from StarTech, which uses a VIA older USB 2 chipset, which is Windows 2000 compatible and will be recognized during the setup. All you have to do is to plug the adapter and that's it. No driver integration is needed. Now let's install Windows 2000 on this socket 1700 motherboard and this Core i3 13th gen CPU. We are starting the installation from DOS. This time I made a DOS bootable partition with the installation files and SmartDrive disk caching utility. We still have to use SmartDrive even if this time we are using a much powerful configuration. The installation will start normally. The DOS part always works no matter what. Our SATA installation drive is using the HCI protocol, and as soon as Windows tries to initialize our hard drive, we'll end up with this infamous blue screen, inaccessible boot device. This happens because Windows 2000 doesn't know anything about the HCI protocol and expects an IDE drive or proper drivers to be loaded from the floppy drive. On some older motherboards, we can set SATA to act as an IDE drive, and this would solve the problem. But on newer motherboards, this is not the case. At this point, we have two main options. First, we can integrate AHCI drivers, or let's call it SATA drivers, onto Windows 2000 CD. There is a detailed guide on how to integrate AHCI drivers into a Windows 2K installation CD, but it only works with Intel chipsets. So if you are using, let's say, an AMD motherboard, you have to go with a plan B, which requires some dedicated hardware. There are many SATA adapters, both PCI and PCI Express, that Are Windows 2000 compatible? Unfortunately, we cannot deliver the drivers using a floppy disk. Windows 2000 expects a real floppy controller, and on USB floppy won't do the job. So now it's a matter of integrating these drivers into the Windows installation CD. For this exact job, we can use nLite. It has an easy-to-use interface. We can integrate drivers in no time. But depending on what drivers are you trying to integrate and what ISO are you using, you may get some errors during the setup. So don't put all your hopes on nLite. There is also a plan C named UNATA, which is a truly universal driver for almost all Windows NT versions. But there is a catch. The UNATA driver, it looks like it can be used during the setup phase, especially if we are using new hardware. So the only way to get UNATA running is to have a working Windows 2000 installation and install it from there. Installing UNATA from Windows, it's an easy job. All we have to do is to run the setup batch file included, and that's it. At the next restart, UNATA will take over. The good news is that UNATA is quite versatile, and it's not linked to the hardware on a specific computer. So once we have managed to install it, we can use that Windows 2000 installation on some other computer. I already tested it and it works. So one way to get Windows 2000 running on modern hardware is to use a pre-installed Windows copy with UNATA drivers on it. Now let's talk about the plan D. Yes, there is a plan D, and this is the way I actually installed Windows on this Intel 13th gen CPU. The initial plan was to use my trustworthy VIA 6421 PCI to SATA adapter, which is Windows 2000 compatible. I did integrate the drivers with nLite in both ways, the PNP mode and text mode drivers. It didn't work, so I had to modify manually the setup files. As far as Windows 2000 cares, my VIA adapter is a SCSI adapter, and all the SCSI drivers are listed in the txtsetup.sif file. So what I had to do is to copy the PCI IDs from the actual driver into this file, and I also had to list this driver on some other sections. You can find some online guides on how to do that. Also, you can look at another SCSI driver and how it's listed on this setup file, and you'll find the formula. It's not that complicated. Oh, let's not forget that you have to copy the actual drivers on the installation CD in a folder named OEM. Now you can witness how my SCSI driver is recognized during the setup, and the SATA drive can be finally put to work. From now on, the installation will simply do its job. What can I say? Maybe this was the most complicated way to installing Windows 2000 by manually modifying the txt setup file. But this is a one-time job. I can use that file on my next installation, so I have granted compatibility with my VIA PCI to SATA card, and I think it was worth it. Now, if you are asking how long did the setup took on this fast CPU, it was under 10 minutes, 8 minutes or so. Windows 2000 setup is not the fastest. You can install Windows XP faster than Windows 2000. This is the way Windows 2000 works. It has to do some heavy computations during the setup, and those computations are killing a 486 CPU. Anyway, when I installed Windows 2000 for the first time on my Ryzen machine, it took way longer than 3 hours to figure all out. So if you have to do it for the first time, as I said, you you might be finish the job faster on an older compatible machine, but once you know how to replicate the process on a new computer, it takes under 10 minutes. A nice surprise is the MPS compatibility of this business motherboard from Asus. MPS stands for a multi-processor specification, and it's quite an old standard released in mid-90s. To check if your BIOS has MPS support, can use a program like System Information Viewer. There we have to navigate to hardware BIOS tables and see if there is any mention about MPS. As you can see, this Asus motherboard supports MPS revision 1.4. At the same time, if I check my Ryzen 9 computer for MPS support, while there is no MPS support, only ACPI, the standard which replaced MPS. Anyway, having MPS support on such a new motherboard made possible to have multi-CPU support on the original release of Windows 2000, the one with no service packs, which was made available in December 1999, which is quite amazing if you ask me. Now I think it's time to end the video. I won't go into installing drivers. The main focus was to solve the disk hardware issues, and I think I covered that part pretty good with a multi-plan solution. Thanks for joining me in this journey through time and technology. I hope you enjoyed this video. Maybe consider to hit that subscribe button. Thank you. See you next time.